Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're gonna continue our space saga and we're gonna talk about Mars habitat. So let's dive right into it. Now, first you have to understand what are the problems that we have to face when we go to Mars. Now, the simplest way to understand this is basically it's like space, as in absolute space, but it has low gravity. Now, that low gravity has some benefits, but it also has some side effects, mainly the fact that you to go there and to come back from there, you have to spend energy, and it would be significantly more energy compared to what you have to spend docking and undocking from International Space Station. So you have to be aware of that. It does have benefit that some of human metabolism will work relatively better, some filtration system will work better, some smoke detectors will work better, fire will behave normally. So it has some benefit, but let's just say it does not have enough benefit to count as any actual profit, but does have enough headache that you have to spend a lot of energy to get in and get out of it. The outer space part simply means you have to be 100% self-contained. You cannot expand even the CO2. You can't just urinate in the space at Apollo project. You have to recycle everything to near to 100% as possible, like as close you can get. So these two are the core starting point. Then on top of that, cherry on top, we have the fact that it has dust. Now many of you might be like, okay, dust is not a big issue here on Earth. Why it's a big issue on Mars? One simple reason, that dust is kind of different and is very fine grained. The fact that it's fine grained, think of it that it can directly enter your lungs and destroy your air sacs. So it's very dangerous for a human, and not to mention it's sometimes can behave in terms of electrostatic systems. So if you get in even small amount of dust in your habitat, inside your habitat, everybody is in danger. And these rovers, they have to be designed very specifically, so they move very slowly so even if dust gets there, it does not grind away things. So, and rovers have to take special care to make sure any moving part that is exposed to dust needs a very special kind of maintenance to make sure that they run for a long time. Now, rovers don't have to worry about many things that humans have to worry about. Now, humans have a lot of moving parts, we have moving parts, and we're gonna have airlocks, we're gonna have space chutes, and all things combined, we gonna figure out a way to deal with dust. And it's not gonna be an issue at first month, but after time it will become an issue. The longer we stay there, the more this dust becomes an issue. And this is a picture from space taken from NASA's satellites, that this is Mars without dust storm, that is Mars with dust storm. So it can cover the whole planet. It's not like how we have tornadoes on Earth. This area is getting hit by tornado, but other area is fine. On Mars is complete, and it can last upwards of 1 month. And on top of that, it is far. Now, what does that far mean? Now, you might say this is also far. This is 400 to 1,000 kilometers, 400 to 500 kilometers away from Earth. And so, but again, if you really want to go to it, you can go there in less than 30 minutes. Best case scenario, best ion engine you can have, you can still spend more than 30 days to go to Mars. So let's just say that that far part really starts to affect you. And this also implies, affects the cost. How much money you have to spend in order to send material, from Earth to Mars. So these are the problems. Now, let's say we wanted to go ahead, no matter what happens, let's forge ahead. Let's forge our path. So where are we gonna actually do it? Underground. Now, the movie, many of you have seen the movie Martian. You can do that if your mission criteria is for short term, as in they were originally targeting for, I don't remember exactly, but it was 30 souls or 60 souls. Basically, few months you don't have to go underground. But if you really want to stay there, if you really want to start a colony there, as in hundreds of people living for their whole lifespan, you have to be underground. There is no debate about it. We don't have any technology to make windows that can filter out radiation. We don't have any technology to make thin material that we can transport from either Earth or make there that can stop large amount of radiation. Now, radiation is not an issue if you are only exposed to it for 6 months, but even a basic background radiation of Mars will start to become lethal if you're exposed to it over years. For that reason, we have to go underground. And it also has extra benefits, if you go underground, we can make sure the habitat is pressurized to one atmosphere. Now ISS has basically this weird strategy where they have one atmosphere for space system, but for the suit, space suits, they have to wear like space suit. They you know, they do extravehicular activity. It's 100% oxygen. Now the reason for that is 100% oxygen means you need less pressure to breathe properly. Awesome. Consequence is 100% oxygen. That means even a minor spark will result into, you know, absolute fire. And 100% oxygen means you can't transition properly. You can't be like in a space suit. You can't be like, okay, I use the space suit for 6 hours. I'm gonna come in and open your helmet. Yeah, you're gonna die, because that nitrogen is gonna cause issues to you. Divers also has to deal with this. So they have a, like, you know, intermediary airlock where they change the atmosphere slowly so your body can handle it. So it's an issue. So if for a practical reason, you have to make sure you are at one atmosphere with a nitrogen. For that, your habitat will expand because that's a lot of pressure. Now to get the counter pressure, either you can make it very strong, thick and big, or you can simply bury it underground. That way you solve the problem. And the fact that it will be insulated using earth itself, as in mass of soil, it will act as a very good thermal buffer. So if you heat it up, it's gonna stay hot for very long. If you cool it down, it's gonna stay cold for a very long time, which is awesome. Now how are we gonna have the illumination if we, you know, we are underground? You can check my full video about illumination there, where you will understand we can't use windows flat out. We can't use windows. Mirror has extra benefits, and that way we can compensate for multiple things. Check that video for full details. Basically, from radiation filtering to allow for much higher illumination, because Mars is very far away, so that noon sunlight is not as bright as noon on Earth. Now we might be like, okay, why the hell we wanna, you know, land in this crater and then, you know, go around the rims? Why not go to the poles? Problem: we don't have the technology right now to go to the poles. Now, satellite orbiting the pole, that's completely different. But if you want to land on the poles, the problem is that because Earth and Mars is almost like a same orbital plane, you launch a rocket from Earth's equator, it goes to the, you know, Mars equator. That's super easy. But if you want to change the direction, you have to spend fuel, enough amount of fuel, so it, you know, it's targeting the pole. Okay, that's one thing. Second, because the pole won't, pole is not a big region. Like equator is a big region, but pole is a very small on top. You don't have enough, you know, aero braking ability that you're gonna slow down enough. You're gonna need a very large propulsive braking to land on pole properly. And not to mention, pole is very cold. Like, this is cold, this is very dangerous, this is lethal. So all things combined, we don't have the technology yet. Now, can BFR land on the poles? Not on the poles, because let's say if it's actually CO2, if it's actually ice, that rocket thrust will freaking melt it, and you know, you're gonna sink there. So let's say close enough, maybe, maybe not, but I wouldn't put my money on it. That's landing on poles is completely completely different ball game. It's very complex. So location wise it's most likely for us to land here and just borrow, you know, either make tunnels or just put habitats as close to the cliff walls as possible and then cover it by soil. That way you can put a lot of them, and even if one explodes for some reason, it won't cause damage to neighboring one. So what is the actual issue? Like all this problem we have solved in one way or the another, one place or the another, is just placing all the technology into one place. The core missing factor is we don't have power. That's the only reason we can't do this properly today. Like if you are talking about sending few people there, like let's say 10 people and doing it for 2 years, we have the technology to do that. But hundreds of people, 10,000 people, we simply don't have the power. Now let's talk about solar. That's the first you know, Elon Musk idea, like we're gonna have solar farms. Two crucial factor. First, the amount of solar flux you have on Mars is much lower, considerably lower than what you have on Earth. So basically, if you have a 100 kilowatt solar panel, that solar panel will barely give you 50 kilowatt, barely, you know, on Mars. Even it's exactly the same panel. You just tested it on Earth, awesome, 100 kilowatt, you folded it, you send it on Mars, you open it up, yeah, it's 50 kilowatt now. And that's optimistic projection. It's in real life, it's even lower than that. On top of that, what you're gonna do at night? On top of that, what you gonna do during dust storms? So it's one thing to build a power station, you know, battery backup that is big, heavy, expensive, dangerous, that can store enough power for, let's say, overnight. Okay, awesome. So basically all you have to do is just double this solar farm. So you are producing twice the electricity, half the electricity is being stored, and then you are using that electricity during night. Awesome. And the fact that there is no rain, the winds are not that big of an issue, and clouds are almost non-existent, it's pretty awesome. But what you're going to do during the storm, which is upwards of 1 to 2 months, and you have to have a contingency for that sort of scenario. For this reason, NASA is flat out letting go of a solar system. What they are focusing on is nuclear. Now, in nuclear, we have two options. We have RTGs that was used in Curiosity rover. Now, benefit, it's basically like a battery that will keep running for 30 years. Consequence, it's very weak. The rover's RTG that we have on Curiosity does not even provide 1 kilowatt of power. Now, so you might be like, okay, let's just send nuclear reactor. That's also very weak. This kilo power nuclear reactor from NASA barely gives out 10 kilowatt, barely. That's its max capacity. Now, that's enough for, like, you know, many things. Like, you can have RTG as backup for your life support, your communication, and RTG will still do whatever it needs to do, but you will have kilo power for bulk load. Like, you know, it will take care of the bulk electrical load. So that way you can support a human mission for a very long time. Awesome. But problem is, if you want to expand it, if you truly want to expand it, you need a nuclear reactor that's providing hundreds of megawatt of power. So because without it, in situ utilization is just a pipe dream. So there are some people who did calculation using this to make a 3D printed habitat. The timeline they got, an optimistic timeline, was 1.5 years if they have multiple of these. So we need power. We can solve any issue if we have enough power. We just don't have the power. That's the final nail in the coffin. That's the sole reason nobody is seriously NASA is like, yeah, we're gonna go into Mars, but being a multi-planet species, yeah, that's a joke, because we can't truly do that yet. We don't have any power source powerful enough that can solve our issues. I'm not talking about like 10-20 people. Like, we're gonna have that in our lifetime, but we're not gonna have colony there. So what's the reality of it? The reality is, we don't have any experience of this scale of project, and it's ludicrously expensive. So this kind of money, it does not have any turnaround. Now, you might be like, almost all space missions have no turnaround. Yes, almost all of them have turnaround. That's why they were getting done. Even with Apollo project, it was a war mission. Like, it had to be done. It was like, let's not start a nuclear war. Let's figure out who has the best space capability, and then we're gonna, talk it out like gentlemen, not, start a mad situation. So it had a reason, but doing Mars project has no reason to be done. Simply, it has no tangible benefit. And the fact is that we have better alternative. Like my video, you can check out, about Mars moon colonization. Basically, not going there to live there, going there to mine and extract. We can do that on moon simply because moon has a lot more solar power than obviously Mars. It has equal to Earth, lot of solar power. The fact it does not have an atmosphere or dust storm or winds, that means you can build a really big structure. The fact that it has low gravity, that means you can use maglev to transport your material. Whatever you are manufacturing, you can transport it to the orbit without needing rockets. It's awesome. Like, we can truly, with current technology, truly industrialize moon, and that way we can have gigatons of material available at our disposal in space. It's cheaper to make it on moon and ship it from moon to anywhere than it is to send from Earth, simply because of our gravitational well. So let's say you did that. Let's say humanity started to doing that, and we had industrialized the moon, and it has benefits. It has hundreds of benefits. Many benefits include, like, imagine having super giant satellites that can really handle petabytes of data per second. Like, imagine a dish. The satellites are instead of 6 or 8 ton, it's 500 ton satellite. What kind of processing power you can put on them? What kind of amplifier and booster you can put on there? Imagine satellite dish that is size of 1 kilometer big. That way you can literally have a cell phone level communication using normal mobile phone using satellites. So there is a lot of room of growth if we did moon, and moon is near to us. It's just 3 days away. So let's say we did that. That has to be done. If we truly talk about humanity to become spacefaring, we have to do that. That's the first step. That's day one. Let's say we did that. Humanity got together, we got our act together, and we started doing it. Awesome. Now, let's say we did that. After that, would you want to spend that kind of energy, resources, and time on Mars, where you cannot do anything about it, or you want to spend it on Venus? To cool Venus down, all you have to do is simply put giant mirror in Lagrange point, basically. That's it. That's all you have to do. And then you have to wait. Now, that waiting part is the biggest problem. You have to wait for 200 years. Now, you're like, okay, that's too long. And not to mention, mirror won't be like, you know, one giant piece. It will be hundreds of small mirror or millions of small mirror. Doable. But, and the small scale of that, we are testing with James Webb telescope, basically is a sun shield, five-layer sun shield, which is the size of a tennis ball. So we have technology. We know it works. It's just, we have to supersize it. So it can be done. And if you have moon industrialization, it's super easy. But the fact that you have to wait 200 years after the completion of that mirror. Now, when I say mirror, I don't mean glass mirror. It simply has to be a foil. That's more than good enough. Thicker the foil, the quicker it will cool down. So let's say 250 years you have to wait. Now, is that a long time? Practically speaking, no. That's a shorter time span than the age of USA. And that's ludicrously small compared to Roman Empire's lifespan. So all things considered, if we put that kind of time, let's say 500 years, that's your target goal. Humanity for 500 years. If you spend 500 year, you can get Earth 2.0. You can actually land there. You can actually walk there. All you would need is oxygen mask. And you can terraform it much easily to basically look like Earth. And artificial lighting is much easier to do than, you know, artificial pressurization. So this is much more adaptable. And if people go there, they can come back to Earth. If you go to Mars, you stay there for long enough, you can't come back because your bone would have been adjusted to low gravity situation, where if you land back onto Earth, your bones will shatter under your own weight. And you can see this. When astronauts come back from zero gravity, they have a lot of bone issues. And it takes time for their bone to regrow back. And we do not even know whether it's possible that regrowth will happen if you are there for, let's say, years. That's why there is a limitation. Astronauts cannot stay in space for, you know, 8-9 years. Even if they have the tech, we'll not keep them there because we know there is a, you know, lifelong consequence of that, flat out being death. And let's say this is the simplest solution. This is what we can do. After we have industrialized the moon, we can build spinning habitats that solve every single problem. And biggest of all, it gives you gravity, it gives you temperature, it gives you pressure, everything you need, you can build that. And it's away from Earth, so it's away from issue. And you can place this at Lagrange point, that is back and front of Earth. So, and those Lagrange points are much stable, L3 and L5, I think. And those Lagrange points are so stable that you can put gigatons and it's not gonna move. Not all Lagrange points are stable, but those are. And you can simply build a spinning habitat and be done with it. You're like, okay, humanity actually have a backup there. So all things considered, Mars, it sounds good because we can do it. Like, you know, we can actually go there. But long term, like if you really pull back and see it, it's like, yeah, we went back to the moon and, you know, then war was over, then we stopped going to the moon. Mars will be like that. So, but in Venus, it's doable. It's just that humanity really has to bunker down for, like, you know, 300 years. So that's the reality of it. Like, it's ludicrously expensive and we have better alternatives. And this alternative is super cheap, the Elysium space station that I'm showing you. So this was my presentation on Mars habitat and what reality exists. So I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. And I would urge you to leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And please subscribe, press the bell icon if you are free, share it amongst your friends. That would be a great help for me. And as always, thanks for watching.